evening, everybody. Welcome to one more webinar from Chess Council of India, also called CCI, where we're going to be discussing a very hot and interesting topic today, which is post-COVID complications. And since COVID is settling, the second wave is settling in most of the parts of the country for next 2 to 3 months, till the third wave comes up, hopefully, which it never will, but till the third wave comes up, we are going to be now managing the post-COVID complications, and therefore it's going to be a very interesting panel discussion today. To join me, I've got excellent panelists from across the country, very dynamic, very bright, and who have done excellent work during this pandemic. It gives me great pleasure to introduce each of them. First, I would like to introduce my very, very dear friend Sonia, who I know for the last 20 years. We work together, we go back to many, many years together, rather decades together. She's extremely bright, extremely enthusiastic, and is a pulmonologist from Baroda working in Sterling Hospital. We have Dr. Divakar Sahu, a young, dynamic chest physician, pulmonologist, who's at AIIMS Raipur, Chhattisgarh. He's an assistant professor over there. We have Dr. Kalpesh Gandhi, a very dear friend of mine, who's a consultant pulmonologist and intensivist from Jalgaon, doing great work. It's really great to see young physicians doing so well. We have a very dear friend and colleague of mine, Dr. Pranali Patil, who's a chest physician from Mumbai. And it's wonderful to see her manage very difficult cases with a sweet smile on her face. And we have Dr. Kirat Sabia, who's an amazing pulmonologist from Ludhiana, who's doing brilliant work, always a smile on her face, but comes up with most amazing queries, and she has a beautiful way of sorting them out on her own, doing fantastic work. So I'm very, very happy to invite each of my esteemed panelists to today's panel, which is going to be on post-COVID complications. I'm Dr. Amita Nene, and I'll be moderating the panel today. And just before the moderation, I'm going to give a small 10-minute overview on this topic, where I'll just be touching upon things, but all the important discussion will be with our eminent pulmonologists, who are the great panelists over here. I think I'll share my presentation. Good evening. Welcome again. So I'm going to be talking a little bit about the post-COVID complications. So basically, we know that there are many, many patients who had variable long-term outcomes after recovering from COVID. And therefore, post-COVID, there is an unknown journey ahead. Similar to post-acute virus syndromes described in survivors of other virulent coronavirus epidemics, there are increasing reports of persistent and prolonged effects after acute COVID-19. The term post-acute COVID-19 is used in this scenario, which is a syndrome characterized by persistent symptoms and or delayed or long-term complications in COVID patients beyond 4 weeks from the onset of symptoms. So basically, the thing is that after you start the symptoms, up to 4 weeks, it is known as acute COVID. And if any symptoms last beyond 4 weeks or develop after 4 weeks, which are not because of any alternative diagnosis, then this becomes post-acute COVID-19. So this post-acute COVID-19 is further divided into two categories. The first one is sub-acute or ongoing symptomatic COVID-19, which includes symptoms and abnormalities present from 4 weeks up to 12 weeks beyond acute COVID-19. So between 4 to 12 weeks, between 1 to 3 months after your acute COVID is over, if you get symptoms, this is known as subacute or ongoing symptomatic COVID-19. This is also known as long COVID and also known as post-acute sequelae of COVID-19. After this, we have chronic or post-COVID-19 syndrome, which includes symptoms and abnormalities persisting or present beyond 12 weeks, even after 3 months of the onset of acute COVID-19, and are not attributable to an alternative diagnosis. So basically, if the symptoms are beyond 4 weeks, then we call it long COVID or post-acute sequelae of COVID. And if the symptoms last beyond 12 weeks, then we call it chronic COVID or post-COVID syndrome. So what is most interesting and fascinating about post-acute COVID-19 is that patient advocacy groups, many members of which identify themselves as long haulers, those who were suffering chronically even after recovering from COVID, have helped contribute to the recognition of post-acute COVID-19, which means that we doctors were just so busy treating patients of COVID that we never thought of this condition. And it was our patients who actually came forward and educated us that post-acute COVID-19 actually exists. And this is because these patients started putting up on different social media reports, because we were not really paying attention to them because we were really overwhelmed with the work. And they started putting up things like, we need to be believed, we need to be helped, treated with compassion, and supported by those around us. So this is what told us that there may be something known as post-acute COVID-19. We still didn't want to take them seriously till Dr. Paul Gardner, who himself is an infectious disease specialist working in Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine, he himself actually wrote up this article in the BMJ Opinion as a personal account. And he said that it's been 7 weeks since I've recovered from COVID. However, I've been through a roller coaster of ill health, extreme emotions, and utter exhaustion. He said, this is not some post-viral fatigue syndrome, but this is a disease itself, which has shifting bizarre symptoms and an unpredictable cause. After a doctor announced this, we all had to actually pay attention to this post-acute COVID-19 syndrome. And lots of patients, you just look at this, 283 days of COVID recovery, but there is still chest pain, tachycardia, extreme fatigue, dizziness, aches. Another patient, 9 months post-COVID recovery, but there is nausea, memory loss, there's disorientation, there's fatigue. So as you can see, there are enough patients who are suffering, and probably we are not even paying attention to them. So what is the pathophysiology of post-acute COVID-19? So potential mechanisms include virus-specific pathophysiological changes, which are direct viral toxicity to the cells, causing cellular damage, endothelial damage, and microvascular injury. The second is immunological aberrations resulting in hyperimmune states and inflammatory damage in response to the acute infection, and also the hypercoagulable state. And thirdly, it's the expected sequelae of post-critical illness, which involves microvascular ischemia and injury, effects of immobility, and metabolic alteration during critical illness. So all these three are the potential mechanisms which result in post-acute COVID-19 symptoms even after we recover from COVID. So what is the magnitude of this problem? So basically, I want to talk about this Italian study, which was published way back in July 2020 in JAMA. So basically, it was just 3 months of COVID, and this study actually came out. It looked at 143 patients, and these patients had recovered 2 months from their COVID. And what was interesting was that only 18%, even 2 months after recovery from COVID, only 18% were completely free of any COVID-19 related symptoms. 32% patients had one or two symptoms at 2 months, and 55% had three or more symptoms. Fatigue was most common seen in 53%, followed by dyspnea in 43%, joint pain in 27%, and chest pain in 21%. What was shocking was 44% of the patients had worsened quality of life, and none of them had any fever. So what is really interesting is that all these were symptoms of post-acute COVID-19. This was seen at 2 months, that is before 3 months got over, and this was all about long COVID. Let's talk about a bigger study which involved 1,700 plus patients, and this comes from China, Wuhan, the place from where this disease actually originated. So they evaluated 1,700 plus patients at 6 months from COVID recovery, and shockingly, 76% of these patients had at least one symptom which was still present. The most common symptom was fatigue, muscular weakness, which was seen in 63%, followed by sleep difficulties in 26%, and anxiety, depression in 23%. So as you can see, the Italian study had more of dyspnea, joint pain, chest pain, whereas the Chinese study had more of sleep difficulties, anxiety, depression, and fatigue was present all through. So just to tell you all that the symptoms are variable in different places and in different individuals. The most common symptoms are fatigue, decline in quality of life, muscular weakness, joint pains. In lungs, the patients can complain of dyspnea, cough. They may have still oxygen requirements after recovery. It can affect the brain, resulting in anxiety, depression, sleep disturbances, post-traumatic stress disorder, cognitive disturbance, something known as brain fog, where people are confused all the time. It causes headaches. Then it affects the heart. Patients complain of palpitations, chest pain. It causes thromboembolism even after recovery from COVID. It can result in chronic kidney disease. And very commonly, there's hair loss, not only in males, but also in females. So as you can see, these are the most important symptoms post-acute COVID-19. But please look at this diagram. There's not even one system which cannot be affected by COVID. So may it be the brain, the lungs, the heart, the liver, the gut, the kidneys, the muscles, the blood vessels. Not just that, even eyes and nose are not spared by post-acute COVID-19 involvement. And I'm just touching upon the different system names, but all of my esteemed panelists are going to go into details and they're going to enlighten us about how to manage these patients. What is really exciting is the inflammation part. So basically, there is increase of inflammation-related cytokines in this autoantibody production. And post-COVID-19, we actually have these two very interesting syndromes which have actually been recognized, which I had never really heard about before COVID. One of them is multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children, also known as MISC, and the other one is multisystem inflammatory syndrome in adults, also known as MISA. I'm just taking the names of this, but our esteemed panelists are going to educate us more about both of these. So which patients are at risk for post-acute COVID-19? So patients requiring hospitalization, more so in those requiring ICU, NIV or mechanical ventilation or HFNC. The more sick patients who have a prolonged stay in the hospital or ICU, those patients who have pre-existing respiratory diseases and comorbidities, and also the patients who have higher BMI, who are old, who are black or Asians. Please note Asians. So we have a higher chance of getting post-acute COVID-19. And also the patients who experience medical complications like secondary bacterial pneumonia, sepsis, or venous thromboembolism are more likely to get long COVID. So please note that symptoms persisting post recovery from COVID are real, and please do not attribute these symptoms to patients' imagination or hypochondriacness. Please take these sufferers seriously. So basically, 60 to 80% of individuals may have some post COVID sequelae. If it's mild, then it's just fatigue and body ache, but it could be as severe as pulmonary fibrosis, requiring oxygen post-discharge, and some patients may even require lung transplant. There could be significant cardiac abnormalities, and even after recovering from COVID, these patients have 6 times higher chance of getting heart attacks, even 3 to 6 months after recovering from COVID. And after recovering from COVID, these patients can actually get strokes, which could be life-threatening, and if not, they can significantly cause impairment in quality of life, and a huge number of patients are actually ending up with mental health issues. So whenever a patient comes to us after recovering from COVID and he's not looking too comfortable or otherwise also, please ask the patient if there's any cough, breathlessness, chest pain or fatigue. Ask about his oxygen requirements, check his saturation and decide if he needs any pulmonary rehabilitation or any onward referral, probably to a cardiologist if the symptoms cannot be explained by lungs alone. Please ask for anxiety, depression, insomnia. Psychosocial assessment is required, and please refer to a psychiatrist if required, because psychiatric complications are quite a few post-COVID. Assess for existing or new venous thromboembolic disease, because this can even happen after recovery from COVID, and consider specific post-intensive care unit complications such as sarcopenia, cognitive impairment, and post-traumatic stress disorder. So impairments most likely to encounter post-COVID recovery are physical deconditioning and muscle weakness, fatigue, impaired lung function, brain fog and other cognitive impairments and mental health disorders and psychosocial support needs. So rehabilitation, including all these facilities, is very, very important, and therefore multidisciplinary team approach is very, very necessary. The management post-acute COVID-19 can be non-pharmacological and pharmacological. Non-pharmacological requires rehabilitation, multidisciplinary team approach consisting of pulmonologists, cardiologists, neurologists, musculoskeletal specialists, and psychologists and psychiatrists wherever required. Patients often require oxygen therapy, yoga, meditation may help, and nutritional support is extremely important because these patients have significant weight loss, they have anorexia even post-COVID, and they also have loss of smell, taste, which does not allow them to eat, and often the diarrhea continues. So looking at this non-pharmacological aspects is very, very important, which we probably might be missing. And pharmacological management is also very, very important, which we're going to be discussing in today's very interesting panel. We're going to talk about post-discharge, what is the role of anticoagulants, which one, for how long. We're going to talk about steroids post-discharge, inhaled, oral, what is the duration, and what is the role of antifibrotics in these patients. So I've spoken a lot of things, I've given a lot of information. Let me consolidate everything in the form of take-home messages. So the multi-organ sequelae of COVID-19 beyond the acute phase of infection are real and are increasingly being recognized. Currently, we, the healthcare professionals caring for survivors of acute COVID-19, have the key role of recognizing, carefully documenting, investigating, and managing ongoing or new symptoms, as well as following up organ-specific complications that develop during the acute illness of the patient. And moreover, most importantly, it is clear for patients with COVID-19, the care does not conclude at the time of hospital discharge. We need to continue looking after these patients. We need to continue to look after them. And interdisciplinary cooperation is needed for comprehensive care of these patients in the outpatient setting. To conclude, a screening protocol and multidisciplinary approach would help early detection of post-COVID complications and would dramatically change lives. Thank you. So with this brief introduction to the topic, I would be happy to start today's discussion. So I think let's revise a little bit. I'd like to ask Dr. Kalpesh first. Dr. Kalpesh, can you please let me know what is the difference between long COVID and what is chronic COVID? Can you please unmute yourself?
Thanks a lot for the question, ma'am. First of all, I would like to thank Team CCI for inviting me for this panel discussion. So coming to the question, long COVID and the chronic COVID is term to describe the effect of COVID-19 that continues for weeks and months beyond the initial illness. The long COVID we describe when the symptoms persist for more than 4 weeks, and for chronic COVID, we describe the symptoms which are lasting for more than 12 weeks.
Yeah, thank you very much. And since you've been doing a lot of COVID work in Jalgaon, I keep on getting great feedback from everybody over there. I want to ask you, which are the most common complications that patients have been presenting to you in your practice post-COVID? The symptoms that they come to you with?
Patient coming after discharge.
After discharge,
the most common symptom is fatigue.
Okay, very good.
They are coming for follow-up. Yeah, fatigue is the most common symptom.
Okay, and what are the other
muscle problems? Weakness.
Yes.
Other symptoms are like cough, shortness of breath, requiring oxygen. Then coming to neurological symptoms, there is psychosis, there is brain fog, some patients suffering of chest pain, palpitation. Excessive sweating is common symptom. Excessive urination at the night time is also common symptom.
That's very interesting.
Loss of hair. Yeah.
Great.
These are the common symptoms I'm getting. Sometimes there is disturbance in GI upset.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Thank you so much. You know, so basically it could be not just cough and breathlessness, but it can actually affect every possible symptom, system of the body. Now I'd like to ask Dr. Sonia, that since chronic fatigue is something that Dr. Kalpesh said is most common, and that is what we also have seen, and most of the studies have reported that. So Dr. Sonia, how would you manage these patients who complain of chronic fatigue and reduce endurance post-COVID? Can you please tell us?
So fatigue is very common, Amita. You know, there are a lot of studies which have shown that 38 to 40% of the patients post-COVID have chronic fatigue syndrome. The approach is going to be, you know, multidisciplinary. So it has to be a holistic approach, to be very honest. So first, ideally, you need to rule out the medical conditions. You know, patients have anemia because of which they develop fatigue. Patient will also have a muscle mass loss. You know, the lean body weight reduces significantly. So evaluation for the body mass index, the muscle mass. Also look at the flare-up of the some of the endocrine disorders, you know, flare-up of hypothyroidism post-COVID, which can cause fatigue. And also most of the patients will have a very poor, you know, glycemic control. So when they have high diabetes, they will always have weakness, you know, so they'll have fatigue. So once you rule out all these things, then, of course, then you put that patient that, yes, this patient fits into a chronic fatigue syndrome once I've ruled out all of the medical disorders. And then the approach is again going to be holistic. So the first thing would be reassurance, a very nice counseling through a counselor, also the doctor, and counseling with the relatives, and relatives helping the patients, you know, to cope up with this chronic fatigue syndrome. Chase insomnia, which is very important. So, you know, we all know that if you and I don't sleep for 3 nights, the fourth day we are going to feel fatigue. So insomnia is one of the most common, you know, symptoms post-COVID. So chase insomnia, rehabilitation, which is very important. And there's a very nice paper by Canadian people where they've given this standard HEAL protocol to follow for this fatigue people for rehabilitation. And the last, if everything is done, think of antidepressants. So, I mean, nominal doses of nortriptyline or maybe a very low dose of modafinil should help. So, in and all, it should be a multidisciplinary holistic approach. And this is because it's very common.
Sonia, thank you so much. You know, it's really, you've told us everything. And what I really liked what you mentioned was, you know, that we have to look for anemia. We have to do a few blood tests. You do look for CBC. You check the sugars because we know post-COVID, there's a higher chance of patients getting diabetes. Look for electrolytes. Patients often have hypokalemia, hypocalcemia. Look for kidney function because often post-COVID, kidney may become abnormal, abnormal SGOT, SGPT, as you rightly said, TSH, because very often there could be hypothyroidism. So basically, as Dr. Sonia rightly told us, rule out all these actual conditions which could be pathological, which could be causing chronic fatigue. And if not, then you look at the other aspects. And sleep is something that she spoke about, which I think we forget about. So thank you so much for this great answer. Now I'd like to ask our young and pretty Dr. Kirat that what are the most common cardiovascular complications and how will the patients present post-acute COVID-19?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. And a special thanks to CCI for having me here again. And definitely post-COVID, patients are coming with a variety of complaints. And when Sonia, ma'am, so beautifully elaborated on fatigue. And fatigue is one of the common presentations when someone could be having a cardiac issue as well. It's one of the early presentations, one of the early symptoms. And people after COVID can have, if they have an underlying coronary artery disease, the risk of having decompensation is further, you know, it is increased, and people are presenting at 1 month and even up to 4 months with cardiac complications like myocarditis, pericarditis. Patients have come with ACS resulting in LVF because of persistent unmasked or persistent unnoticed inflammation leading to a procoagulant state, leading to plaque ruptures, ultimately resulting in an MI. And so for such patients, we have to follow the standard investigations and standard evaluations. Also, I would like to mention here, the common presentations are palpitations. Patients will talk about being breathless. Very typically, they will talk about, they'll complain about feeling breathless after climbing even 4 steps of stairs. They will talk about feeling that their heartbeat has gone up when they exert. So in such cases, we should also keep in mind the possibility of postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, and further evaluation is required. And postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, or POTS, has even been reported for children as young as 14 years of age. And people have presented with POTS even up to 4 months after having had COVID. So we need to have a high index of suspicion, and then obviously evaluate for all the cardiac causes. And we have to understand that ongoing myocardial inflammation is persistent and has been reported for up to 6 weeks. And but we don't generally get a cardiac MRI, and so that goes unnoticed. Most important, when a patient comes, do not invalidate the patient that this is okay or you know, this is nothing. Reassurance is of great help to the patient, and patients, I have found, they seek a lot of comfort when we tell them that you are not alone. This is common, and we are keeping a tab on your status. We are getting serial investigations done, and reassurance really helps them.
Thank you, Dr. Kirat. So this is very, very nice. The way you said, we have to be sympathetic, we have to be compassionate, and we have to listen to our patients and take them seriously. What I really liked was that we all know that MI happens, congestive cardiac failure happens, there's cardiomyopathy, you know, there's plaque rupture, there's ongoing myocardial inflammation. What I really liked was 2 points that you said. One was fatigue, which was very important. And the second thing was the tachycardia that you spoke about, because it's a tachycardia also, which makes the patients extremely uncomfortable. So thank you very much for so beautifully covering up all the cardiovascular complications and the presentations. Now I'd like to ask Dr. Divakar, our senior pulmonologist over here, who's got so much of experience in managing everything. So Dr. Divakar, can you please tell us that what are the tests to confirm these cardiovascular complications, and how will you manage patients with these cardiovascular complications?
Okay, ma'am. At the outset, I like to thank the CCI and the office bearers for giving me opportunity to have in this panel discussion. As Dr. Kirat has rightly mentioned, that so many cardiovascular complications do occur in these patients, and we usually see those patients who are sick, and we generally forget after discharging the patient from the hospital that you are well and you can now go home. We discharging patients with home oxygen therapy with a concentrator or the cylinder, but we usually do not get those type of patients because of heavy workload. Here we are in the managing more than 11,000 patients since the inception of the COVID-19 in AIIMS Raipur. As a pulmonologist, we usually work in only the COVID ICUs. And in the general wards, there are so many patients who usually do complain of tachycardia, more of anxiety. The factor of anxiety we usually miss in those patients, though they are isolated, they are kept in a separate ward. No doctor of ear contact with the eye-to-eye contact. We usually clad in the PPE. So there are so many factors. But after discharge, they usually come with the complaint of chest pain. Chest pain, I usually found so many so common in this part. And this sinus tachycardia is the commonest symptom which I am seeing post COVID. So if a patient comes with the chest pain, should usually go for the serial ECG. And the cardiac evaluation like echocardiography to be done in every patient who comes with a chest pain, as well as patients with orthostatic tachycardia, as well as mentioned inappropriate sinus tachycardia. Those patients has to be managed at the early, because sinus tachycardia with the palpitation is a very worrisome feature, and patients who have having some ventricular dysfunction has to be corrected at the early and has to undergo serial echocardiography so that they can be managed as early as possible. cardiac MRI also not usually done in our center also. But if the patient, we were suspecting a patient of myocarditis, which is quite common in every viral infection as well as the COVID, and which usually are goes unnoticed, and we are not able to diagnose this viral myocarditis before the COVID-19 also. So due to heavy load in every center, I don't think it is a common practice to do cardiac MRI in every patient, but you can do. And I am seeing so many cases of autonomic dysfunction in patients with COVID-19. We have a study of autonomic dysfunction in post-COVID patients, yet to publish the paper. And you can do this in those patients, in cardiac autonomic dysfunction patients, heavy breathing exercises are to be done. They are sympathetic overactivity in those patients. In few patients, I have seen also that there is sinus bradycardia, and mostly during the treatment. But post-COVID, I haven't seen those. And low dose beta blockers may be given in those patients with like bisoprolol, in those patients with postural orthostatic tachycardia and inappropriate sinus tachycardia. That's it, ma'am. Thank you.
No, I mean, excellent answer. So basically, please do serial ECGs, please do 2D echoes. Cardiac MRIs, we are not doing that frequently. But if you're thinking of ongoing myocardial inflammation, maybe you can consider doing TROP-T, TROP-I serially. Anti-proBNP may sometimes help us. And as he very rightly said, Dr. Dibakar, as he rightly said, beta blockers are very, very useful if we've ruled out asthma. And then beta blockers would be quite useful to these patients. And of course, if patients are on ACE inhibitors, we know now that for COVID patients, ACE inhibitors are to be continued and not to be stopped. So thank you, Dr. Dibakar, for enlightening us about how to manage these patients who've got cardiovascular complications. Now let's come back to our favorite topic, the lungs. So I'd like to ask dear Dr. Pranali, who's been doing excellent work in Mumbai, about a simple question that we all are faced with, but I'm sure she'll have very important answers to give us. So Dr. Pranali, can you please tell us, what are the respiratory symptoms and manifestations of post-COVID complications?
Thank you so much for asking the question, ma'am. First, I would like to thank Dr. N. H. Krishna and the CCI Core Committee for giving me the opportunity to become a part of this excellent panel. And coming back to question that madam asked, as you previously discussed in the slide beginning of our panel discussion, you correctly mentioned that if the patient have a predisposing factor for the complications, and these are the main categories in which those patients are the long haulers, or they tend to be our chronic patients in post-COVID. So mainly the complaints from these patients are the respiratory basic complaints never tend to be relieved completely. So they keep on persisting, complaining about the cough, whether it is dry or productive, or occasionally they get a bouts of cough. Most of the time they complain about hoarseness of the voice. There is this pharyngitis. The breathlessness never goes away. It is persistently there, and no matter how much you are giving the inhalers and everything, it is still there, and that is contributing to their daily activities and causing the limitations. So for the basic task also, they have to take help of their attendants, and the chest tightness is also persistent. So that is very important symptom that we see on day-to-day basis, but that never tends to leave the post-COVID chronic patient. So this causes a lot of trouble. So as we discussed earlier regarding the cardiac complication, while assessing this breathlessness, we have to think about cardiac component as well. While evaluating and treating for the pulmonary part, we have to look for the cardiac component as well, and we have to ask them to do serial ECGs and 2D echo, and also we have to look after whether they are having any other contributing factors or underlying thromboembolic complication. So to rule out that, we have to go ahead and ask about CTPA. Also, serial evaluation of inflammatory marker is important. But this is all about the chronic COVID patient. But surprisingly, what I've seen recently is that many patients, they tend to have suffer from mild COVID. They are also coming back after 1 or 2 months and complaining about pharyngitis, chest tightness, breathlessness. That, and they are saying it that way, that why are we having it now? We did not. We had absolutely nothing apart from anosmia and dysgeusia during our COVID-19 quarantine period. But why are we having these symptoms now? And what is the cause of it? And that, because of so many social medias and the news updates and everything, they themselves are going out and getting the CT chest done and coming with a higher score of CT, and then they are getting scared, and that is where they are sorting out at our opinion and thinking, okay, why now have I got the relapse of COVID, or they are aware of the relapse of tuberculosis and the typhoid and everything, but they are coming to us and asking, yeah, wapas aaya kya, so do we have to do the RT-PCR again? So counseling, as Sonia ma'am correctly said, Dr. Kirit said, that counseling and assurance is an important part of the first line treatment of our post-COVID management has become. But to evaluate them, we have to have a tailored approach, and we have to analyze the patient clinically, then radiologically, and also we have to assess their inflammatory markers. Also, we have to get their pulmonary function tests like spirometry and 6-minute walk distance. Most of them are accustomed with the 6-minute testing, as they have been doing it at home since they were home quarantined. So this has to be taken care while treating the patient in respiratory symptoms. The manifestation that has come across post-second wave is mostly the lung fibrosis, the thromboembolisms, the organizing pneumonia, and the bronchitis. And some of them also have opportunistic infections, secondary pneumonias, and very few have also come across as a coexisting tuberculosis and COVID-19 infection. So while evaluating, it is always has to be case-to-case basis, and clinical assessment is the center line, mainstay of the assessment.
Thank you, Dr. Pranali. You know, so nicely, you've actually covered up everything. In fact, my second question, you know, my first question was, what are the symptoms and manifestations? And I was going to ask you what investigations you want to do. And luckily, you answered both in the same question. So I'm very, very happy that you gave a very bird's eye look to the entire thing. So she very nicely told us that in addition to cough, breathlessness, chest pain, they also complain of pharyngitis. And very often, they go and do their own CT scan. And how we have to actually answer their questions, you know. But what I really liked what she said, which was that even people who had mild COVID, who didn't even require hospitalization, probably they didn't even take any treatment, they were only taking vitamins and resting at home. These people are also ending up getting post-acute COVID-19. And this is a very, very important point, that we have to listen to our patient when they come to us. And no symptom of this could be ignored, because post-acute COVID-19 is real, and this ongoing inflammation and hypercoagulable state can go on for as long as 6 months. And I kind of feel, you know, that when there was bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there were like not just years, but there were decades and centuries and generations who came out with the mental stress. And I just hope that this doesn't happen to COVID survivors, because I think this COVID agony may just go on for years together. So thank you, Dr. Pranali, for this very good answer. Now I'd like to ask Dr. Kirat, that Dr. Pranali has told us about all the respiratory symptoms and all the respiratory complications. So can you please tell us, how will you manage these various respiratory symptoms of cough, breathlessness, and chest pain?
So as Dr. Pranali also said, that reassurance goes a long way. And when someone comes, first of all, we would like to see the severity of COVID that the patient had, a lot of times the new symptoms or the persistent symptoms may not correlate with the severity of pre-existing COVID disease or the COVID in the past. Patient may not be have been on oxygen or in the ICU, but still is now coming with breathlessness or easy fatigability or having a CT score, which is, the patient feels alarmed. So a lot of time I like to tell them that, see, maybe when you got the CT scan done, at that point, it was on the lower side. It worsened and it came down. So do not see this CT as a complete picture. Do not see this as an endpoint. And the CT changes do take time to clear off. So depending on the complaints of the patient, especially when they are coming with complaints of breathlessness or chest pain or cough, always I would like to go in for a detailed cardiac and pulmonary, both evaluation. Assessment has to be both for the pulmonary status and the cardiac status. Then I obviously would like to know if the patient has any background underlying risk factor or if the patient was already having any underlying pulmonary disease. Maybe the person was asthmatic to begin with. A lot of patients I've come across, they continue to take nebulization post discharge also. They have this belief that nebulization is essential somehow to management. So we have to make sure that people are not over medicating. We have to also see if the patient has been put on any medication, like say nitrofurantoin, which is for UTI but is also known to promote pulmonary fibrosis, or maybe on any antiarrhythmic, maybe on amiodarone, also known to cause pulmonary fibrosis. So a detailed evaluation of the patient's background status, comorbidities.
Can you get on the treatment part, Dr. Kirat? How
the medication that is ongoing?
What medications would you like to control the cough, the breathlessness and chest pain?
Depending on the cause that we can find after investigating, if there is no evidence of inflammation, I don't think that steroids are indicated at this point. Even inhaled steroids are seldom helpful and seldom indicated. I would only put a patient on inhaled medication after I get the PFTs done. I think there's a lot of overprescription of these MDIs and Revolizers and Rotahilas and all. So we need to actually tone that down. Breathlessness, when we know that breathlessness can be because of, even postural orthostatic tachycardia syndrome, it can be underlying cardiac disease, which is decompensating. So after evaluating, we treat for the underlying cause. And if we cannot find any cause, which happens more often than not, then we still do not over-treat the patient. We reassure the patient. We tell the patient that we are keeping a tab on your status. You are not alone. We are going to be in touch with you. Also, I want to draw attention to the fact that a lot of patients are prescribed exercises, breathing exercises at home. Yoga is so popular. And when we tell patients who have autonomic dysfunctions or dysregulation, doing deep breathing and breath, deep breathing is fine, but very aggressive yoga breathing exercises, which are involving very forceful contractions of the abdominal muscles, or breathing exercises where they have to have breath holding, they can further precipitate tachycardias. They can further precipitate, the autonomic dysregulation. So we have to advise them against doing this. I'm very specific when I tell the patient that, see, at least for 1 month after COVID, do not indulge in vigorous exercises. You can go in for mild walks. You can go into, you have to start conditioning your body again. Do not indulge in rigorous exercise. We have had cases, we have all read about it, myocarditis and sudden cardiac deaths in young people because they went in for very rigorous exercise. Do not push them on weight loss post-COVID. We want them to be happy and healthy. We don't want to be, fatigued and underfed and unnourished. So all these things actually go a long way. And for these respiratory, obviously we need to rule out, as Dr. Pranali said, the cause, we need to see tuberculosis and any other infectious cause. After ruling that out, when we can't find anything, we need to have a holistic approach. We cannot continue to, just push them further and further on drugs, which are neither helping nor even reassuring.
Yeah, thank you very much. So this was very nice. And when there's cough, there's breathlessness, chest pain, Dr. Kirat specifically told us that we have to understand that it need not be only respiratory, just because we are respiratory physicians. And very nicely, she said that we have to have a holistic approach and rule out other causes, find the cause and then treat. And very often we don't have to necessarily treat just because patient is asking for something. And this is also very important what she told us, that heavy exercises are not, even including breathing exercises, are not the best way forward, and start with gentle stuff. This reminds me of something very important that I read, that if patients who are athletes who get COVID, which may even be mild, and if they want to go back to their physical activity, which is so much more than our activity, then actually it has been said they do a cardiac MRI, rule out myocardial inflammation, do a TROP-T, TROP-I, and only if it's fine, then over 3 to 6 months, they can go back to their original activity. Because people with mild COVID who are athletes are known to otherwise have some major event while they go back to their original endurance levels. So with this, now I'd like to come back to Dr. Kalpesh. We gave him too long a break, so I'm going to ask you something difficult, Dr. Kalpesh. So I want to ask you, after discharge, went, or maybe you can even say while in hospital and after discharge, when to use steroids, the doses and the duration.
Steroids we use when actually we first do the inflammatory markers, CRP levels, D-dimer levels, serum ferritin levels. If they are raised and patient is symptomatic, then we need to start them on steroids. And we will give them small, short duration and small doses in tapering doses. Mostly we give them on methylprednisolone or the deflazacort in tapering doses. For 14 days,
okay.
14 days to 1 month, depending on the condition of the patient, how the symptoms are resolving.
Okay, so I'm very happy that you are not agreeing with the recovery trial, which says that you give dexamethasone for 10 days and stop. So there's a very important statement which Dr. Kalpesh has come up with, which I completely agree with, that steroids need not be stopped at 10 days. So can you tell me in which conditions, which patients would you like to continue steroids for more than 10 days, Dr. Kalpesh?
When persistent higher levels of CRP, ferritin and D-dimer levels, we will continue the steroids, because steroids suppresses them and patient symptoms get decreased. Because some patients after stopping steroids, the markers again start increasing and patient again becomes comes with symptoms. So in those patients, I do start them on against steroids.
Okay, so we completely agree with Dr. Kalpesh. Thank you so much. So in addition to the inflammatory markers, what I normally do is I also look at the saturation of the patient when he was admitted. And if the saturation was less than 95%, then I tend to give steroids for about 2 weeks. If the CT scan is like moderate, then I like to give for 2 weeks. But if the saturation was less than 90% of their severe involvement, then I tend to give steroids for 3 weeks. And if patients are hypoxic, requiring oxygen, then I even give steroids for more than 4 weeks. Some patients, very few, have been on steroids for up to 3 months also. So thank you, Dr. Kalpesh, for letting us know that steroids can be continued for more than 10 days. This was the answer that I was looking for, and thank you very much. Now I'm going to come to...
I have continued, ma'am. I have continued steroids for 3 months in some patients. Initially, their X-ray was totally white out, but on follow-up, after giving a low-dose steroids, the X-ray got completely normalized and patient becomes symptom-free after small dose of steroids for a long time.
Yeah, so excellent. So we know that the pneumonia of COVID is steroid responsive. And as Dr. Kalpesh has rightly told us, and as he's been doing in his patients, you discharge them on a small dose of steroids, maybe 30 to 40 milligrams, and you keep on tapering it. You don't want to continue it, but you don't want to continue large doses. You keep on tapering and you find the smallest possible dose, whether it's 10 milligrams or 5 milligrams for your patient. You can give it for up to 3 months also. Some patients may require longer. But thank you, Dr. Kalpesh. This is a very useful clinical tip that you've given us, because there are a lot of chest physicians and most of the intensivists and medicine physicians, they just feel stop steroids at 10 days means stop steroids at 10 days. And they sit and argue with us when we give steroids to them for longer period. And they want to quote the recovery trial saying, look, 10 days and steroids were stopped. So this was a very important point. Thank you very much, Dr. Kalpesh. Now I'd like to come to Dr. Sonia. So we were saying that for pneumonia, we want to give steroids, etc. So let's go one step forward. So which patients have a higher chance of getting post-COVID lung fibrosis? That is one question. And I'm adding a second question to it. What are different strategies to reduce COVID-associated pulmonary fibrosis? So difficult questions. First, answer the first question. Which patients have a higher chance of getting pulmonary fibrosis post-COVID?
So before I start, thanks to Dr. Narendra, Dr. Doshi, and Dr. Krishna, and of course, Amita, who always pushed me to become a member of CCI. I would rather elude Amita that rather than, you know, which patients, I would rather talk about the risk factors, you know, the risk factors. And these are basically extrapolated from IPF, because we've seen a lot of, couple of studies which shows that there is a correlation between this risk factors and that of an IPF. And also some of the extrapolation from the SARS and the MERS epidemic. And these are, you know, patients more than 65 years of age. The other thing is the severity of the disease. And what do I mean when I say severity of the disease? It is basically the radiological severity, to be very honest. Then it would be the length of the ICU stay. That means the severe illness in the ICU. The other thing would be the duration of the mechanical ventilation and the oxygen requirement. So the patient remaining on a very high flow oxygen for a long time are the potential candidates who would probably go on and develop lung fibrosis. And then there are some skeptical reasons which I would like to, you know, which would probably need more trials would be lymphopenia, leukocytosis, very high CRPs, raised IL-6. And very important is RDW, that is red cell distribution width, which is more than 14.5, where the patient would really become very critical. And then some of, you know, the some histories like smoking, chronic alcoholism. So, you know, in a nutshell, all these things, all these factors extrapolated from previous studies would probably have a likelihood of developing lung fibrosis. Now, coming to your second question, what should be done? Very important thing is when the patient is in the ICU on a mechanical ventilation, try to reduce ventilator-associated lung injury. And what do I mean by that? Very importantly, give a lung protective ventilation. That is a low tidal volume, low inspiratory pressure. So target the plateau pressures, which should be less than 30 mm of Hg. Avoid a barotrauma or a volutrauma. Give adequate oxygen and try to taper it off as fast as possible. Target saturations around 92. I mean, you don't have to make the patients run at the saturations of 95 or 96. 92 or 91 of sets are more than sufficient so that you can come out down on FiO2. Once the patient is discharged, ask them that they should avoid exposure to environmental factors which can trigger lung injury. And most importantly, regular follow-up with the patients who have recovered from serious illnesses in terms of lung physiological evaluation, that is spirometry, diffusion lung studies, 6-minute walk test, and very importantly, as and when required, HRCT thorax. I hope I have answered your question.
Yeah, excellent. I think you've covered each and every point, you know. You basically told us that patients who've got more extensive disease, that is, you know, more involvement of the CT scan, more areas involved in the same lobe, people who've got, people who are old, who got more serious disease, more inflammatory markers, people who are already smokers, alcoholics, these are the people who've got a high chance of getting COVID-related fibrosis. And I'm very, very happy that Dr. Sonia actually told us how to be careful so as to prevent of lung fibrosis from occurring in these patients. I would now like to come to Dr. Divakar, and I want to ask him something very, very hot, something which is a very hot question, that how common is thromboembolism post-COVID how can it manifest and how can we prevent thromboembolism post-COVID? So the role of anticoagulation post-COVID, etc. Tell us everything about thromboembolism and anticoagulants.
Anticoagulation and thromboembolism is now the hot topic in COVID management. But looking at the post-COVID scenario, there is no, definitely not much data. Even the ACCP and all, they haven't come up with any data about how long you have to continue the. As we all aware that COVID-19 causes the thrombotic phenomenon inside the lungs, microvasculature, as well as the pulmonary thromboembolism may happen. So we usually give this low molecular weight heparin in patients or unfractioned heparin in patients with COVID-19. But after this disease process over, then how much it is not that much written, or I haven't gone through any paper like that. In patient, antithrombotic therapy is mainstay in moderate to severe in illness of this COVID-19. Post COVID-19 thromboembolic manifestation is not common, but venous thromboembolism, especially the lower extremity, has to be looked for because of long stay in treatment, this post COVID fatigue and post COVID chronic oxygen therapy patients continue to remain immobile. So that has to be looked for, venous thromboembolism, as well as because of this chronic hyperinflammatory state and hypercoagulable state, we should look for this venous thromboembolism in patients. In one study, in a multicenter study in Europe, they found around 7.8% of venous thromboembolism in post-COVID patients. This is quite high, I think. Only one study I have found. ACCP guideline is also not recommending any thromboprophylaxis. But in our setup, and we usually do this D-dimer. And if the D-dimer is more than two times, you can give this NOACs in patients post-discharge. Mainly rivaroxaban, apixaban are given post-discharge in those patients, and you have to follow it up with 4 to 12 weeks this venous thromboembolism in those patients. Even these patients, Dr. Pranali has told, Dr. Kirat has told that these patients land up with this acute coronary syndrome also. Few patients. So that's why you should consider this either this low molecular weight heparin after the discharge or this apixaban in those patients.
Yeah, very well answered. That even after COVID, recovery, patients have a high chance of getting DVT in the legs, because of which they can get pulmonary embolism. As Dr. Devakar rightly told us, acute coronary syndrome can happen. Patients can get MIs. These people can actually even get strokes post-discharge, and some people actually get systemic arterial emboli, like a gangrene or something. So basically, venous thromboembolism and arterial thromboembolism post-acute COVID is known. He very nicely also told us about the study where they said that about 7% or 8% patients post-COVID get venous thromboembolism. That was very important information. And as he rightly said, those patients at the time of discharge, if their D-dimer is more than twice the normal, then it would be quite justified to continue oral anticoagulants, NOACs at home. And also, otherwise, if people have other predisposing factors for DVT, like if they're going to be immobilized or bedridden or something, then continuing this would be useful. I personally feel that if CRP is high, then I somehow prefer to continue NOACs. I have not read this anywhere. This is my personal experience, that I prefer to give the anticoagulation till the CRP becomes normal. Any of y'all are doing that, or I'm the only one doing that? Okay, fine. Okay, great. Now I would like to come to Dr. Kalpesh. So I want to ask you, when should we repeat HRCT chest in a patient who's recovered from COVID?
That will be a clinical decision.
Yeah, so CT chest, the HRCT, CT
patient pulmonary. Is coming with, So if patient is breathlessness, he has persistent tachycardia, then we should go for CT to see if there is any increase in shadows or if there is any thromboembolism that we can get from CTPA. Some patients also present with happy hypoxia. In those patient, there is no breathlessness, but when you see the saturation, it is low. So in those patients also, we need to repeat the HRCT chest to see whether there is any increase in shadows or not. Or else we can also do a 6-minute walk test for coming for follow-up. In those patients, if there is decrease in saturation, we should also do the CT to see any increase in involvement of lung.
Okay, thanks. So basically, I feel that normally recommendation of CT scan is about 4 to 6 weeks after a symptom onset of COVID. A routine, just a follow-up CT, and it's not recommended any time before 4 weeks. So ideally, we prefer to do it at 4 to 6 weeks. Of course, you can do it earlier if you're suspecting some infectious complication. We have a lot of fungal infections going around this time, or it could be something like that. If you're suspecting pulmonary embolism or something, then CT pulmonary angio could be done otherwise. And if the patient is having a good course where we are not expecting any complication, then maybe a CT can be repeated at the end of 3 months from the first CT, because by then we would expect the CT scan to become okay. But if at all you want to decide about your steroids, or if you want to decide about any infection, etc., then in between CT could be done. If it's for a patient who's doing well, you could do it at 4 to 6 weeks. But if suspecting infection, then do a CT scan, because we all know left lower lobe is not well seen on a chest X-ray and we can always miss it. So thank you, Dr. Kalpesh, for this answer.
May I add something, ma'am?
Please, please, all the panelists, please keep on adding. Dr. Divakar, Dr. Sonia, please go ahead.
I have seen two, three cases of patients not very chronic after 8 to 10 days. The requirement of oxygen has gone up, and after CT, they found that there is pneumomediastinum. This air leak syndrome we are seeing so many cases of air leak syndrome in this wave. Actually, in the last wave, we haven't seen that. The exact cause is not known, but we are seeing so many air leak syndrome. And in patients who are actually there in our ward, in ICU, requiring prolonged ventilation or an IV support, they usually we can do this PA view. So AP view goes on notice. This with such a bad lung, with this pneumothorax and the pneumomediastinum goes on notice. So in those cases, we can, if the patient suddenly requires higher oxygen, then we can go for a CT to rule out this pneumomediastinum.
Excellent point. Before I ask Dr. Sonia, Dr. Devakar, this was an excellent point about pneumomediastinum, pneumothorax. I just want to add one thing, which I also put up in the CCI group last night. So basically, the thing is, if the patient is supine, if there's a pneumothorax on a chest X-ray, there's deep sulcus sign in which the costophrenic angle on that side will be much deeper as compared to the costophrenic angle on the other side. And this is the only indication where the dome of the diaphragm is going to become much deeper. And this, if it's on the left side, and if the costophrenic angle is more than 1 centimeter below, or 1 rib space below the right one, then, or if the right one is same as the left one, then this is an indication of a pneumothorax in a supine patient. And of course, bedside ultrasound would also help. And if the patient is stable to be shifted, then the CT scan would be the best and the most diagnostic thing. So very important point brought out by Dr. Devakar. And thank you, Dr. Devakar. And Dr. Sonia, you want to say something? Please tell us. Okay.
Welcome, sir.
Sonia, how?
Yeah, Amita, normally we have one baseline CT scan when we admit the patient. On discharge, normally I don't repeat the CT scans, but if the patient continue to have a refractory hypoxemia, and to some extent, you know, the oxygen requirement suddenly increases. And that's the time I would probably order for a repeat CT scan if there's a significant decline even in the lung function. So that's the time we should. Otherwise, you are right. 4 to 6 weeks is the right time if the patient is on oxygen with, you know, declining lung functions.
Okay. Also, ma'am, may I add that you will have loss of the ventilatory settings will give a idea as well. You know, not able to hold the inspiratory pressures, loss of tidal volumes, you know, the fluctuations there, they also give us an idea that we are dealing with, you know, air loss, air leaks somewhere.
Yeah. Post-COVID.
Oh, yeah, not post-COVID.
Follow-up
HS. When Dr. Divankar said, you know, in the ICU.
Yeah. It's a very important clinical point to add. If there's a pneumothorax, then there'll be a difference of more than 100 between the inspiratory and the expiratory tidal volumes, and the peak pressures will shoot up if the patient is on volume control mode. So, and of course, there could be BP coming down, and there could be tachycardia, etc. So, of course, clinically, we know we should be doing this very important point. Now, Sonia, I want to ask you something which is very interesting and controversial. I think let Dr. Krishna come in first. Dear Dr. Krishna, welcome.
Hello, everyone. Hello. Am I audible to everyone?
Yes, sir.
Hello, sir.
I don't.
Yeah.
Hello, Dr. Amita, the Prime Minister today. Namaste. And the entire cabinet. See, I'm here. I don't rush in like this in any webinars. Why I'm here today?
Yeah.
Okay, there's a special announcement. Huh? So it's just a span of few weeks, around 3 weeks back, we had the record logins of 1520. Later, which was broken by 1664. Then it was broken by 1750. Today, the logins are 1880. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir.
So all records tumbled down. Beautiful. I'm so happy. Kudos. Great going. Continue.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And I want to make an announcement. There are 1,263 questions which have already been posted. We'll have to stay awake all night, maybe for one full week to answer them. But thank you so much, team, for doing an awesome job. And a huge big thanks to Dr. Krishna for always coming up with the most innovative topics for all the CCI webinars. Thank you for giving us an opportunity, Dr. Krishna. Dr. Narinder, Dr. Ravi Dosi, Dr. Pradeep Narayan, Dr. Vijay Kumar Chenam Chetty, and Dr. Atri. A big thanks to each of you. So let me just continue.
Congratulations for the industry hit. 1880 logins.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thanks.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Dinner today. We have to break for dinner.
For dinner, yes. But now let me go and ask a question which has been asked by at least 50 viewers already. I have not gone on the next page. So, Sonia, I'd like to ask you this question. What is the role of antifibrotics in patients of COVID-related lung fibrosis? And when would you use? In which patients would you use?
We had discussed this yesterday. I have my own distinct thoughts, to be very honest. I would take some 5 minutes on this. Some of the, you know, debatable points that I want to quote in. You know, the histopathology of the post-acute COVID is very mysterious. And whatever we know of diffuse alveolar damage and most of the histopathology is postpartum of severe COVID, and which is extrapolated. So this histopathology of all post-COVID is mysterious, number one. Number two, most important thing that I would like to say that we have seen so many epidemics. We have seen H1N1. We have seen a lot of ARDSs. No, you give time to the patients. They would probably resolve over a period of time, and it depends on the patient to patient basis. Some would resolve over 3 months, some would resolve over 4 months. And most of the times we have seen that there is a good parenchymal resolution. The fibrosis which sets in this patients who have ARDS is an acute type, and it is not progressive, to be very honest. And when it is not progressive, it does not fit in the terminology of ILD or PFILD for that instance. Other thing is the role of antifibrotics. You know, antifibrotics would take some weeks to act. Would there be any role of those antifibrotics which would act in 3 to 4 weeks is a big questionable. We know that pofenidone, we, you know, build up a dose of 2,400 or 1,800 over weeks, and then it would take more weeks to act. The same holds with nintedanib. You know, nintedanib also takes some weeks to act. So, I mean, would this act in the 3 to 4 weeks of acute fibrosis, which is a huge question. However, you know, there is a caveat. If I have my patient who is stuck up in the ICU on a non-invasive ventilator or on a very high flow oxygen, which is at around 60 to 65% or 70%, I'm not able to reduce that. You know, I'm waiting for him to have a spontaneous recovery. I mean, I'm exhausted of all my, you know, resources. That is the time, you know, selection of such patients with the selection of the risk factors that I alluded before, combining this two, I would think of giving an anti-inflammatory, that is steroids, along with antifibrotic. So these are this small cohort of patients where I might consider, considering the risk factors, adding an antifibrotic. And my drug of choice would, because that would be a next question by the, you know, my drug of choice would be nintedanib. And we all know that nintedanib has worked in PF-ILDs through the inbuilt study. I hope I've answered your question, Amita.
Yeah, very well. So I'm very, very happy to hear this, because somehow I've seen that people have a very low threshold of writing antifibrotics in COVID. And I want to say that we all know that COVID fibrosis, COVID pneumonia is actually responding to steroids. We talk about antifibrotics in IPF because you cannot give steroids lifelong, because it has not been found to be useful in IPF patients, whereas steroids are useful in patients of COVID. And I don't see any reason why every patient of COVID fibrosis or who's difficult to wean should be going on antifibrotics. Having said that, I totally agree with Dr. Sonia. Only those people who got very extensive lesions where we are stuck, we are not being able to bring down the FiO2, or very early they start showing traction bronchiectasis or honeycombing. If those people, or people who have ongoing fibrosis, for example, acute COVID is over. After that, you did a CT scan and the symptoms continued and patient's oxygen requirement went up and the CT scan showed that there's ongoing fibrosis. That is the only time you may want to add antifibrotics. I also agree with Dr. Sonia about, I prefer using nintedanib. First of all, because you start the full dose of nintedanib 150 twice a day, unlike pirfenidone, where you have to slowly step up the dose. And you don't have that much time to step up the dose by the time it starts working. Only care that we need to take is that people who are on optimal use of anticoagulations, if they are on BD doses, then nintedanib has a higher chance of causing bleeding in the lungs. So just be careful about this. Not that we've really seen this, but this is something that we need to remember. So thank you, Dr. Sonia, for dealing this very controversial topic and giving us your stand, which I think all of us agree with. So now I'd like to ask Dr. Pranali, getting Dr. Pranali back. So what is the role of vaccination? You know, we've not been reading much about the role of vaccinations in patients of COVID. So can you tell us what is the role of vaccinations and what vaccines do you prefer and in which order?
Yes, ma'am. As you mentioned, there's not many data available to read about vaccination guideline in post-COVID patients. But as we are discussing the post-COVID syndrome and the chronicity of the illness, the majority of our respiratory patients are chronic. So after we do our job with the pharmacotherapy, we look after and we treat them optimally, and we optimize them, we stabilize them, and we look at them and think about them, think about what's next. So after optimizing and the symptom control, what we look for is the prevention of the exacerbation or the prevention of a superadded infection or prevention of a complication. So that is what we aim for. So that's why we turn towards the vaccination. So if the post-COVID symptom is turned out to be the chronic respiratory condition or the chronic condition in itself with the underlying comorbidities also in a moderate to severe patient. So as we opt for our old patient, we can, I think, give them these post-COVID patients also give them benefits of vaccination. So right away, I would say once the patient has been discharged and clinically stable and there is no hypoxia, there is no neurological symptoms like GBS, like symptoms available, then we and with as we thoroughly evaluate each and every patient before vaccination, there are no other contraindication, then I think we should go ahead and recommend them influenza vaccination, the latest and available at that moment. And along with that, we can advise them to get vaccinated for pneumococcal conjugate vaccine also, because if the patient already have a moderate to severe illness in the past, then there might be a certain underlying lung condition, and there might the lungs may be frail and easy to catch another infection. So it is advisable to give them both the vaccination at different anatomical site, of course. And after the initial vaccination is over, we can recommend them the polysaccharide pneumococcal vaccine after minimum 8 weeks duration. Anyhow, our COVID patients would have to wait minimum 3 months to get vaccinated for COVID. So in meanwhile, we can utilize the time and give them benefit of this vaccination.
Thank you. This was very, very useful, because we know that we should keep a gap of 1 month between any vaccination and COVID vaccination. So Dr. Pranali very nicely has told us that give the influenza vaccine and the Prevnar 13, and 2 months later just give the pneumo polysaccharide 23-1. So the very important useful clinical tip. Now I'd like to come to Dr. Kirat. So a little difficult question, but you know, actually I'm just trying to quickly cover questions from the audience, so let's keep it very brief and short. So what is post-intensive care syndrome, Dr. Kirat? How will you prevent it and how will you manage it?
Okay, so post-intensive care syndrome or post-ICU syndrome is basically any new or new onset or worsening of the cognitive, mental or physical status of the patient after the critical illness. So this comprises of, when we talk about mental or cognitive, and the mental part will consist of, you know, issues like depression, issues like dementia, issues like post-traumatic stress syndrome or post-traumatic stress disorder, and any cognitive impairment like decrease in attention span, or, you know, other inability, brain fogging, very common. And when we look at the physical aspect, see, in the past also we were noticing this in patients after any critical illness. They would have, critical illness, polyneuropathy, polymyopathy. So the physical aspect can now also, it has been brought into to contain the pulmonary incapacitation that the patient feels after COVID. And so other than that, you know, muscle disuse, atrophy, so all these, they lead to deconditioning, and the patient, you know, a lot of time patient who has walked into the ICU is not able to walk out of the ICU. So a change in this system, I'll talk about how to prevent it and manage it as well. But so when we talk about managing it, preventing it comes at the front end intervention. That would be when the patient is still in the ICU, you know, making sure that we are checking delirium, looking for causes of delirium. We are making sure that the mental status of the person is intact. We're trying to ensure that obviously we cannot, we have to use sedatives at times. We have to use neuromuscular blockade at times, and we cannot help that. But along with that, looking at other functions, like trying to, a lot of focus in our ICU has been on day-night sensitization, you know, making sure that during daytime, the curtains are pulled apart, the patient is able to see the sunlight. So the patient has a sense, an orientation of daytime and nighttime. It also helps in regulating the sleep cycle, right? Other than that, awakening the patient when the patient is asleep and trying to have longer awakening periods during the daytime, and then conditioned and controlled breathing. A very, very important role comes here, you know, with the physiotherapist. They have a big role to play here, you know. And then enabling the patient, early physiotherapy, early mobility, early mobilizing them. I think a really wonderful example that I've noticed is that in Canada, they have a protocol that if a patient, when he comes into the ICU, whatever is his baseline physical status, he will go home or she will go home after he has attained at least that much basic physical status. So if a patient was able to walk till the toilet at home, and after a certain set period in the ICU is not able to do that, the shift bed does not need to be in the ICU anymore. They will shift him to community rehab center. So once the patient has attained that level of physical wellness, and obviously mental assessment has to be there along with all this to see that the patient does not need any mental rehab. We should be very, very open and quick to get cross-reference. We should be welcoming the psychiatrist, their opinion, it helps. We should be welcoming the psychologists. They have a crucial role to play. This is teamwork, after all. Managing a patient in the ICU is teamwork. And preparing the patient to go home has to be a teamwork where the family also comes and becomes a part of the team. I believe all of us have noticed that, we have all the closed ICUs, which were previously not allowing cell phones, allowed cell phones during the COVID period, because the maintaining the mental stability and the state of mind of the patient was very essential. And it became integral.
Right. No, so thank you very much, Dr. Kira, for letting us know that PICS is a syndrome, where people who've had multi-organ failure or probably required mechanical ventilation, and they basically undergo some cognitive, neurological or physical deficiencies. So this is the PICS. And as Dr. Kira rightly said, rehab is important. Please get them oriented to day and night. Please maximize their interaction with the family, and also try to avoid hypoglycemia and hypoxia in the ICU as much as possible, because these will help PICS, and try to mobilize them as soon as possible. Get the physiotherapist in quickly. Thank you, Dr. Kirat, for telling us all this. Now there's a question for Dr. Divakar, which about 23 people have asked. That's what I've counted. So I'm asking you three questions together to make it quick so that I can try to ask all the questions. So what are the post-COVID neurological complications, number one? What are post-COVID neuropsychiatric complications, number two? And number three, what are the causes of these neuropsychiatric complications? So you can include everything together quickly.
Briefly, this post-COVID, before this, at the start of this COVID, everyone has thought that COVID cannot cross the blood-brain barrier. But the S protein in the COVID virus, they attaches to the AC2 receptor in the vascular endothelium, as well as they cross the directly damage the blood-brain barrier, as well as induces the inflammatory response in microvascular endothelial tissues. So neurological complications are very common during the stay, but in the long term, they have like everyone has mentioned, this fatigue, this headache, this loss of concentration, memory loss, neurological, other neurological injury. In long-term complication, in a study in Italy, they have found that neurodegenerative disorders are also, they are seeing this Alzheimer's disease, this Parkinsonism, multiple sclerosis. They have found in patients with long-term, but those are patients are in the higher age group, this fifth or sixth decade person, they have seen those patients. So it is very difficult to say that these are previously been there and undiagnosed. These complications like ischemic or hemorrhagic complications, they goes on with the patient, and we have this post-COVID this type of picture. Then the neuropsychiatry, as everyone has mentioned, neuropsychiatry, anxiety, this post-traumatic stress disorder, this chronic malaise, myalgia, and anxiety, and these are all very common in neuropsychiatric illness. And this neuropsychiatric illness may be because of the hyperimmune response. This may be due to this post-infection autoimmunity and autoimmunomodulatory therapies we are giving, like steroids, IVIG. They may cause this neuropsychiatric symptoms in long term. So we are very fancy, and many of us believe that steroids are mainstay of treatment post-COVID also. So this steroids may cause this psychosis. And as already mentioned, Dr. Kirat has told about this ICU psychosis, ICU delirium. These are also, we are also seeing so many patients of delirium and depression in patients post-COVID. So these are our, my take on neurology and neuropsychiatry. Any other thing we have to, any question I have missed, ma'am?
Yeah, so you told us the neurological complications, and that was important that in addition to loss of taste and smell, there are so many other things like that you mentioned, encephalitis,
Guillain-Barre,
Alzheimer's, headache.
This olfactory knobs are mainly going, this virus is going through the olfactory knobs into the brain. So that may be the cause of this neurological complication.
Completed neurological, even neuropsychiatric, you told us everything about the anxiety, depression, psychosis, etc., loss of sleep, insomnia. You covered everything. And what was really good was that you told us the causes of these complications, which you said it was reaction to virus, it was hyperinflammation, and it was medications. I was just thinking that very often these neuropsychiatric things happen because patients are isolated, they are away from their family, that causes depression. Then there's a stigma. A lot of people don't really get over the stigma, I got COVID. And at the same time, they're very scared of infecting others. So these things also add on to these neuropsychiatric complications. So thank you, Dr. Debakar. Very briefly, you included everything. Thank you very much. Now, one very hot question. I think 100 people or more have actually asked this. I'm just looking at questions which are asked by most of the people. So Dr. Sonia, you tell us, what might be the connection between COVID-19 and increased incidence of mucormycosis? The nation wants to know.
So, very high incidence of mucormycosis that we are seeing. And again, Maharashtra is topping the table for invasive mucormycosis. Yesterday, around 1,250 invasive, active mucormycosis cases. Three most important factors that I would like to allude is, number one is, India is the diabetic, capital. So, uncontrolled hyperglycemia, and then again, COVID-related hyperglycemia is one of the reasons for the fungal infection. Number two is rampant use of corticosteroids. I mean, we have been told that, ideally it should be 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kilogram of dexamethasone or equivalent of methylprednisolone or hydrocortisone, which is to be used. And of course, every one of us have seen people using 5 to 6 times the doses of corticosteroids. And I have also seen a lot of prescriptions were pulsed with corticosteroids. So then this corticosteroids induce hyperglycemia, and it's a vicious cycle. And this forms a fertile ground for the fungal infection. And the third, which is very important, is, the tropical nature of our country. So what we see is there is a huge amount of mucor spores in the indoor as well as outdoor environment, and we breathe in day in and day out. So these are the three most important factors. The other factors which I would like to, which are not very important, is, the contamination of the oxygen bottle with water, the tubings of the oxygen and the filters, which probably would be contaminated. Then the immune dysregulation, that is in a dysregulation between the T cells and the B cells because of the COVID virus infection. And this COVID virus also causes ciliary dysfunction, which can cause, increased risk of opportunistic infections. And most importantly, Amita, I would like to say, which I would like to, stress upon is, and this is the best forum for this, is cocktail of antibiotics which are used in conjunction with corticosteroids. And this is what I really call it as an invisible pandemic. I mean, there is no need for using so many antibiotics just on the basis of rising CRP or PCT or just one symptom. People go on adding antibiotics and they continue with steroids, and that causes a huge fertile ground for, the invasive fungal infection. And one more thing I would like to say, this is not a black fungus. And let us be very, this is to be taken home. Mucor is caused by mucoralis, which is not black under the microscope. And so this term, this is a misnomer, a misconception. It's not a black fungus. Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you very much. Excellent. I just missed a little bit the cilia you were saying about, the respiratory cilia or the nasal cilia?
Respiratory system ciliary dysfunction.
Yes, thank you. So this was, Dr. Sonia has covered every point. There was something very important that I heard actually from an ENT surgeon from our hospital who's been operating all the time. And he blames the entire mucor epidemic too. People are really just so enthused about taking steam inhalation. to prevent COVID. And according to them, the steam inhalation on daily basis, 2 or 3 times a day, even post patients who are recovering from COVID, that is actually affecting the nasal ciliary function. Mucus is present everywhere, and that is allowing the mucus to enter the body. So I think we should just discourage too much of steam inhalation that we are doing. Excellent answer, Sonia. Now for Dr. Kalpesh, I have a difficult one. Kalpesh, there are lots of people who ask this question. What is MISA? Multisystem inflammatory syndrome in adults, not in children. I'm asking you about adults. So basically two questions for you. What is MISA? And how will you basically diagnose it? Means what is the condition? How will you diagnose it? What investigations management? Quickly tell us, please. So four questions for you.
MISA has been described approximately 2 to 8 weeks following previous COVID diagnosis or a known or suspected COVID-19 exposure. The working case definition for recent CDC case series has included a severe illness requiring hospitalization, person aged more than 21 years, a positive test result from current or previous COVID infection. It can be either antigen or RT-PCR during admission or in previous 12 weeks. Severe dysfunction of one or more extrapulmonary organ systems. That can be hypertension, shock, cardiac dysfunction, arterial venous thrombosis, or acute liver injury. Lab evidence showing severe inflammation, elevated CRP levels, ferritin, D-dimer, IL-6, and most important, absence of severe respiratory illness. We should consider MIS in patients with fever, with alternative etiology, lab diagnosis, cardiac manifestation include chest pain, arrhythmias, elevated troponins in the absence of ACS, elevated BNPs, reduced ejection fraction on echo, shock requiring vasopressor support. Hematologic manifestations include lymphopenia, thrombocytopenia, relative decrease in platelet count associated with lab evidence of hyperinflammation. That is neutrophil predominant leukocytosis, ESR more than 50, CRP more than 150, ferritin more than 500. GI manifestations include abdominal pain, diarrhea, elevated liver functions. Neurological manifestations include altered mental status, meningitis, encephalopathy, seizures. Skin and mucosa manifestations include non-exudative conjunctivitis, mucositis, unilateral cervical adenopathy, edema of hands, feet, rashes over the body. For the diagnosis, patient with suspected MIS, we do the following test. We do the first RT-PCR, IVIG antibodies, CBC, CRP, ESR, fibrinogen, ferritin, procal, blood culture, chest X-ray for abdominal imaging like CT scan of the abdomen, USG, 2D echo for rule out any congestive heart failure, then ECG interpretation, and we need to include all the teams, cardiologists, hematologists, infectious disease specialists, rheumatologists, when the diagnosis is not clear. So it is a multidisciplinary approach rather than our single pulmonologist. Coming to the treatment, IVIG is used in the dose of 2 gram per kg, and its maximum dose is 80 gram months. And we give Clexane 40 mg subcutaneously when there is no hyperinflammation. When there is inflammation, hyperinflammation is present, we add steroids in the dose of 1 milligram per kg, BID for 3 days, followed by tapering.
Excellent. You've just covered everything. I believe you already have 3 cases of MISA. I kept this question for you because, you know, when we were discussing, you told me about this. So what I want to say is that just like we had MISC, we have MISA also. And the diagnosis is 2 to 8 weeks after getting COVID. And it's all hyperinflammation. But it's involving a system other than respiratory system. You've ruled out infection and other causes which can cause this, and treatment is IVIG, low molecular weight, and SOS steroids. Excellent. There are certain questions about MISC also. Before that, this one question has been asked many times. So I'll ask Dr. Pranali to answer this question. So what is the role of rehabilitation in patients who've got chronic lung conditions post-COVID or any condition post-COVID?
As I told you, as we discussed earlier, that many of our chronic respiratory patients, when we optimize them, we want them to get more better. So apart from pharmacological therapy, what we look for is a physiotherapy. But as Dr. Kirat mentioned earlier, that physiotherapy doing on your own or teaching just randomly once or twice and letting them do at their own is pretty may cause many complications ahead. And as we all work in different places, so cardiac MRI won't be that accessible. And as you mentioned, that letting people do their routine endurance training and everything after doing the cardiac MRI is pretty difficult in our scenario. So many of our chronic respiratory patients have benefited greatly with the supervised and well-designed and tailored pulmonary rehabilitation programs that has tremendously led to increase in their functions and the exercise endurance as well as their muscle mass and everything. So while advising a patient who is a post-COVID sequelae, so we have to ask them to take a proper consultation from a physiotherapist, and we have to design a individualized pulmonary rehabilitation program, and not just for the respiratory system per se, but we have to look for the underlying muscle wasting. We have to provide a proper nutrition, and we have to pay attention at early mobilization along with the rehabilitating the lung condition. So I think it would play a greater
Excellent. No. So basically the thing is that COVID care does not end when you send the patient home. We have to make sure that we look at the patient from many other aspects also. Dr. Divakar, many, many questions now on MISC. What is multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children?
Dr. Kalpes has already told about MISA. This is basically almost same as MISA. A few points I want to discuss about the differences. What are the differences? Like this is also a multisystemic inflammatory syndrome in children. So as per WHO, this less than 21 year age group, people with less than 21 year age group with features suggestive of features of fever, then elevated inflammatory markers, patients with multiple organ system, more than equal to two organs other than this lungs is involved, and we have to exclude other possible causes of this, then to think of MISC in those patients. The patients usually present with fever, abdominal pain, vomiting, rash, diarrhea, and other cardiovascular manifestation, also cardiovascular compromise, they usually manifest. And usually they can be categorized into three categories usually, and can be categorized in three categories, like fever without any with raised inflammatory markers, fever with raised, and few patients they get features of Kawasaki's disease. This Kawasaki disease usually common in children less than 5 age group, but MIS is more common in the teen age group as well as more than 9 years in 9 years of age group. But patient usually present with Kawasaki's disease, as you know, is a medium vessel vasculitis disease. So they have this cardiac compromise status. Cardiac involvement, myocardial involvement is very common in those patients. And this is a immune mediated response, autoimmune mediated response, more complement activations, and as well as autoantibody formation in those patients post-COVID. And as per the current recommendation by the CBC, first you have to give those supportive therapy like fluids and oxygen and ventilators as per requirement, vasopressors. But this immuno is Dr. Kalpas has already told, this immunomodulatory therapy like IVIG and steroids are the mainstay of treatment. And in patients with to be given in this children, this low dose aspirin has also recommended in those patients. And therapeutic anticoagulation also been recommended to give, like warfarin, enoxaparin to be given. And serial echocardiography to be done. And if the ejection fraction is less than 35%, then documented thrombosis is there, then should go for this therapeutic anticoagulation. And serial echocardiography to be done on regular basis. And to rule out this myocarditis, should go for this MRI, cardiac MRI.
Absolutely. Thank you very much. Excellent answer to the point. So basically, COVID can really create a havoc in the body, can play with the immunity, can affect autoimmunity and cause diseases. And actually, we need to identify this disease, because treatment is not just steroids. Treatment is actually IVIG. And this can also happen in adults. So a very important entity. And so many of our audience have asked this question. Now, a question for Kirat. Kirat, I'm again combining two questions for you. Many people have asked, what are the renal complications of COVID and what are the skin complications of COVID?
Okay, so coming to the renal complications, most people who have had a new onset AKI during COVID, they generally show a resolution in the RFTs, but there could be some persistent decrease in GFR even up to 6 months that has been noted.
Right.
And we have noticed, especially infectious, before Mucor came into the picture, I think the most common infection that we were seeing post-COVID were people who were coming after 6 weeks or after 4 weeks with UTI. And mostly people who were diabetic, they would come. There was even generally, even if the PSA was normal, we would see some evidence of urinary retention. And this was very common. Maybe the autonomic dysregulation after COVID was causing this. And most common organisms that we've noted in our area was E. coli and Klebsiella. And this is, I'm talking people coming from home care setting. I'm not talking about ICU setting. And then we have now for COVID, we have COVID-associated nephropathy. That is now a known entity, which is actually a variety of focal segmental glomerulosclerosis. And a lot of patients who have had chronic renal disease in the background, they have shown persistent deterioration after COVID. They have shown that increased dependence on dialysis. Patients who had had kidney transplant in the past had not been on dialysis, were doing relatively well. After COVID, they have had have gone into failure again. Some of them had to go back on dialysis. So we have seen this persistent decline in renal status post COVID. Mm-hmm. And
just summing it, then you can go to the skin ones. So very well said. It results in acute tubular necrosis. The GFR actually can continue to drop even after you recover from COVID. And what Dr. Kirat most importantly said was about the urinary tract infections, the most common cause of fever post COVID. There are so many questions about fever post COVID. I hope we get time for it. But thank you even for talking about COVID, which is a new entity post COVID, the COVID induced nephropathy that you told us about. So thank you so much about the increased renal replacement therapy dependence, everything you've covered. Can you please tell us about the skin complications post COVID?
Skin complications, mostly people are reporting that the reported and documented is that they are complaining of hair loss. But we have to understand that after any critical disease, after about a span of 6 weeks or 6 weeks to 3 months, there is shedding of face, the exogen phase of hair loss actually comes about. So it is not limited or particular to COVID, just that it has been documented for COVID. And most common is rash. For the rash, people are coming after COVID. People are coming with rash at 4 weeks, at 6 weeks, even at 2 months. I've seen people who have come with rash, abrupt onset, not itching. There is absolutely no correlation with the severity of COVID in the past or even with CRP or ongoing CRP levels at the point, at that point. So do not try to correlate them. Only thing to notice that it is going to be blanching, it is going to be not itching, these the typical COVID rash. You do not need to give steroids or even oral or topical for these. Just good emollients and good moisturizing and good skin hygiene is all that is indicated. Overall, that's all for skin, you know.
Perfect. Very well answered. What we are seeing is a lot of fungal infections on the skin. People are coming with tinea, probably because of the diabetes and the chronic steroid use.
Only seen in few. I have only seen two patients who have come with fungal infection. But these were the patients who also seen fungal vaginitis post-COVID. But these were the patients who already had history of fungal issues in the past. No new onset after COVID.
What I'm seeing is what I've seen over and above. It's not given any books. I was just trying to say. And we've been seeing some ulcers, digital ulcers in people who've been on high doses of vasopressors. So that's something that we are seeing. Post-COVID, they're coming with digital ulcers, etc. And yeah, so that is something. Sonia, one question for you. Many people have asked, what is the role of ECMO? What is the role of lung transplant? I'm asking you about ECMO because I know currently you've got some 4 or 5 patients on ECMO currently. So who better than you answering this question?
6 to be precise.
6, okay.
Okay. So the role of ECMO is 2. One as a rescue therapy and the other as the bridge to lung transplantation. So let me come to the rescue therapy. So when you have a patient who has got refractory hypoxemia, after invasive mechanical ventilation, after you've done everything, you know, you've done a complete neuromuscular blockade, you've done a lung protective strategies, you have done, you're doing a proning and supining completely for 24 to 48 hours, following all the protocols. However, the patient is hypoxemic, where the PO2 by the FiO2 ratio is less than 100. So that's number one. And then you also look at, the compliance of the lung goes down significantly. What do you mean when the compliance goes down? The PCO2 is more than 70 to 80 in spite of all the, ventilatory strategies, and the pH goes less than 7.2. So pH less than 7.2, PCO2 between 70 to 80 or more than that, and a refractory hypoxemia. So this is the criteria where you can offer a rescue ECMO to those patients. Having said that, there are certain criteria that needs to be fit. Too early ECMO is not recommended. Too late, that is 7 to 8 days after invasive mechanical ventilation, the outcome is not going to be that good. The age should be less than 65. There has to be a single organ involvement. And most importantly, less or manageable comorbidities. Now I'm talking this about a VV ECMO when I'm talking about refractory hypoxemia in lung patients. However, we have also seen, and Kirit has also very nicely described the cardiac manifestation. So we see myocarditis, we see cardiomyopathy, we also see congestive cardiac failure. So when you have a cardiac associated myocarditis or acute cardiac failure, those patients would go for VA ECMO. Okay, so that's the role of ECMO. Talking about lung transplantation, so the true effect of lung transplantation in acute setting of COVID is very minimal, to be very honest, because most of our COVID patients, and you have more experience than me, Amita. We see that most of these COVID patients, they would, progress to a multi-organ involvement. They would also have multi-organ dysfunction. They would, succumb to sepsis, septic shock. So those are not the criteria to put on a list for lung transplantation. However, there are certain pointers which we consider, which would probably give us a good output in terms of lung transplant. And those are, there are 10 points, and there's a very nice paper in Lancet, which says, and this 10 pointers, if they, fulfill, then they would probably should be on the list for lung transplant. One is age less than 65 years of age, a single organ involvement. You have to give enough time or invasive mechanical ventilation for the patient to recover and wait for a lung transplantation. There has to be a good radiological association that there is a documented fibrosis and it is progressive and not reversible. Patient has to be awake to discuss a dialogue for lung transplantation and the consent for the same. The patient has to go for a lung rehabilitation program before the lung transplantation. he has to be SARS-CoV-2 negative, which is very important. And it has to be done in a center which is really well versed doing a lung transplantation in post-acute COVID. And all those transplantations should have a good list of donors. Also, they should be very, you know, vigilant enough in controlling up waiting list mortality. So these are the patients who would probably fare for lung transplantation.
Excellent, Sonia. Thank you for covering everything. Dr. Pranali, I want to ask you, what are the gastro complications of COVID?
The gastrointestinal complication of the post-COVID mainly that correlates with the presenting symptoms at times, the persistent diarrhea or the diarrhea that presented initially as a symptom of COVID, then it stopped because of the symptomatic management and everything. Once we discharge the patient and patient is on its own and lost to follow for say 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and then again they might complain about having a persistent diarrhea, they might not be having that much number of loose stools per day, but the consistency is keep on being loose all the time. There is dyspepsia, there is bloating, the fecal shedding of virus is very well known, but the more than these complications, not much data is available regarding the manifestation of gastrointestinal symptoms, but there are many studies that that are evaluating the triggering factor of because of COVID infection, whether the irritable bowel syndrome and dyspepsia is getting triggered and amplified, like rest other underlying condition that are getting triggered up and they are getting flare because of the COVID infection. So many studies are underway. So we'll get to know more about it. But so far I have seen dyspepsia, loose stools, bloating as of now, as of GI complications.
I completely agree. Yeah, Sonia? I want to ask last two questions after this. Yes, Sonia, quickly.
Amita, a lot of GI perforations that we are seeing.
Excellent. And we are seeing
ischemia also.
And pancreatitis and cholecystitis also we have been seeing post.
Yeah. So, cholecystitis, pancreatitis, mesenteric artery, ischemia and thrombosis we are seeing. And we are seeing a lot of anorexias which are continuing, which people are blaming to loss of smell and taste, which is continuing. And there's a lot of malnutrition, which is because of catabolic state, because of post PICS. So that is also there. And people are getting some swallowing dysfunctions, etc. So a lot of gastro involvement also. Thank you, Dr. Pranali, for letting us know. Dr. Divakar, you please tell me, what are the endocrine involvements?
Endocrine involvement, as Dr. Sonia has already mentioned about the diabetic capital. India is a diabetic capital. So most of the patients end up are undiagnosed diabetic patients who are not previously diagnosed. They after the admission and due to the steroids, high dose steroids, blood sugar level are erratic. They are very, and people end up with diabetic ketoacidosis also in patients who are not diagnosed previously. Post-COVID, these patients continue to remain on a higher glucose level. Their blood glucose levels are higher. I have seen so many prescriptions of insulin therapy after COVID, discharge of COVID, and they settle very late. These sugar levels are settled very late. And in a study in a retrospective study in Chinese population, they have found that this thyroid is commonly directly affected by the virus. They affect this hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis as well as on the thyroid gland, so that the TSH are at the lower side, pre-T3 and are found, and the pre-T3 are less in those recovered patients. Mechanism is not very much sure, but I read that AC2 and transmembrane serine protease in the beta cells and beta cells of the pancreas are more commonly involved. And and also other endocrine complication, mainly this demineralization of the bone because of the immobility, because of the hyperimmune response. as well as the systemic inflammation and steroid therapy. These are very common in demineralization. So vitamin D has to be given in for a long-term basis in those patients.
So excellent. Diabetes, diabetic ketoacidosis, longer requirement of insulin, and thyroid is really affected. We actually have seen Hashimoto's thyroiditis have been reported.
Yes, Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Yeah.
And also autoimmune thyrotoxicosis and Graves' disease also. And this osteopenia and demineralization of bones, very important. Thank you very much for covering everything. Last two questions. One question for Dr. Kalpesh and one for Dr. Kirat. So Dr. Kalpesh first. A sweet question which has come from the audience. What are the most worrisome post-COVID complications and what are the least troublesome post-COVID complications according to you?
Most worrisome problem is pulmonary fibrosis.
Okay.
And least worrisome is anosmia.
Okay. Very good. Dr. Pranali, can you tell me what
because, fibrosis patient requires...
No, agreed. Absolutely agreed. I totally agree with your answer. Dr. Pranali, can you tell me what is your answer on this?
Ma'am, for this question, there might be two aspects, most worrisome and least worrisome for the patient aspect as well as for the treating doctor's aspect. But we'll look into the patient's aspect. If a patient is having persistent hypoxia and breathlessness, cough bouts, the insomnia, nightmares, anxiety, palpitation, this can be most worrisome problems. And apart from that, as Dr. Kirat mentioned, that hair loss is the most worrisome for the patient, and loss of appetite. Every time after handing over the prescription, our patient as well as the attendant ask, khane mein kya dena hai? So the appetite factor comes first in our Indian food genes. And as Dr. Kalpesh correctly said, least worrisome is probably little bit remnants of anosmia, dysgeusia, and maybe poor perception of some cognitive factors like loss of concentration or a little bit attention deficit issue is there. So that might be go unnoticed for longer duration. So this could be less troublesome at initial presentation.
Yeah, very well said. You know, I like this part. What is difficult for the patient? What is difficult for us? I agree with both of you. I just feel in addition to pulmonary fibrosis, what I've struggled maximum with is pulmonary embolism and patients who've had either strokes and people who've had MIs. This is something which has been extremely frustrating. Dr. Kirat, I would like you to sum up everything. We've had such a wonderful, discussion today. So Dr. Kirat, can you just give us 1 to 2 take home messages from your point of view? To all of us and all our wonderful delegates about post-COVID complications, what is your 1 to 2 take-home message?
Number one, COVID treatment does not stop when the patient is discharged. It is going to continue and maybe even for quite some time, and we have to be there for the patient. Secondly, do not invalidate the patient. Be there for the patient. Reassurance goes a big way. Very essential role of steroids and anticoagulants when we can justify their use, guided by serial investigations. And finally, we also very important role of rehab. And finally, we are targeting not just the patient's survival, but also quality of life. Like CCI is targeting the quality of information dissemination. So, it has to be a comprehensive outlook.
Wonderful. Very beautifully summed up. Any of the esteemed panelists want to add something to this?
And to add that, this is NS Krishna's message that this post-COVID is like you have to deal with like a road traffic accident. There are multiple fractures, road traffic accidents. So it takes time to heal. But we don't have to ignore the patient's small complaints also. I've seen patients with chest pain, ECG normal, and this chest X-ray normal, and when sent to the cardiologist, they are saying there is infraval akinetic features of infraval. So should not ignore. But thing is that with so many patients and very little time to look for the post-COVID patient. Once they are discharged, we think our job is over. But it's not that. Your job has to go on. And as a pulmonologist, you can't be away from COVID for next 2-3 years. I don't think it is.
Sonia, you want to say something? Very well said. And the fact is that we don't have the time, but we should now take our time or have alternative people doing this in our place.
So I have two things. One is, you know, COVID is a multi-system disease and we have seen multi-system complications. So we, along with the other allied specialties, should be on vigil, you know, rather to identify that and chase it out. And most important thing is we should now concentrate on the preventive aspect even when the patient is inside in the hospital. So that means rehabilitation inside the hospital, good nutrition in the hospital, and counseling, which is very important in the hospital itself, which would then continue at home. And then frequent teleconsultations and counseling would help the patient. This is what. And one more thing, a request to Dr. Krishna to even do a webinar on out of COVID or maybe a non-medical thing, something where he takes out curricular activities of the doctors, who is a singer, who's a painter or something like that, which would, you know, take us out of the post-traumatic stress disorder. So, Amita.
Okay, thank you. So, a huge big thanks to each of our esteemed panelists, Dr. Divakar, Dr. Sonia, Dr. Kalpesh, Dr. Pranali, and Dr. Kirat. Y'all have performed brilliantly well. I have learned so much from y'all. I think it's been most exciting and most enlightening webinars I've attended till date. A huge big thanks to Dr. Krishna and the entire CCI core committee. A huge thanks to Sipla also for technical support. I'm very happy and proud to say that till now, even now, 2 hours later, we have 1,880 people who are still logged in, which I think is a huge record and just says how useful this discussion has been. And I just feel that just like post-COVID complications, patients are suffering. I think there is a need to coin a term which talks about the mental stress, complications, the fatigue syndrome, and everything that we are going through. So I think CCI should coin a term and we should have a next webinar on this, the saga of the treating doctors of COVID. With this, I'd like to thank everybody once again. Thank you very much, all our delegates, 1,880 delegates with 1,342 questions. I think it's a record of its own. And thank you very much. Everybody, please be safe. Keep smiling and shining. Take care.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, everyone. It was wonderful being here.